إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله بعد. Today is Thursday, 5th Muharram, 1446, corresponding to July 11th, 2024. Today, inshallah, we will start the short story of Al-Husayn ibn Ali, radiallahu anhuma. This is written by Ibn Kathir and translated to English. And this is taken from the big book, Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya, the beginning and the end of Ibn Kathir, where he speaks about the beginning of creation all the way until the signs of the hour, and the stories of many people and many khulafa and many incidents that happened throughout history. So this is a Bidayah al-Nihaya. The book Bidayah al-Nihaya is a great book, but this is a short story of Husayn ibn Ali, is taken from there. So we'll go directly to the biography of Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhu. So Ibn Kathir rahimahullah says, before elaborating on these aspects of his life, the life of Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhu, it is necessary to provide a brief biography first. His name was Al-Husayn bin Ali bin Abi Talib bin Abdul Muttalib bin Hashim Abu Abdullah Al-Qurashi. So his nickname is Abu Abdullah Al-Qurashi Al-Hashimi, because they are the descendants of Hashim, as we saw here. And he, Husayn radiallahu anhu, is the son of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's daughter Fatima Al-Zahra, Allah pleased with her, who was the Raihan of his world, the sweet smelling basil of the world of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Qatada states that Al-Husayn was born 6 years and 5.5 months after the Hijrah to Medina. So after the Hijrah occurred by 6 years and 5.5 months, Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was born. And he was the second one after Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu. Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, as we'll see later, became Khalifa after Ali radiallahu anhu, but then he succeeded the throne to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, so that the Muslims can be joined under a single leader and a single banner. That's why that year was called Aam al-Jama'ah, the year of the unison. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did foretell in his lifetime that Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu is going to be the means for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for two great groups of Muslims to make peace. Because before this, there was war between the different factions of the Muslims because of fitna that the hypocrites caused by killing Uthman radiallahu anhu. And Uthman radiallahu anhu was from the family of Muawiyah ibn Sufiyah radiallahu anhu. And Muawiyah radiallahu anhu has, under Islamic law, the right to ask for the blood of those that killed Uthman radiallahu anhu. However, Ali radiallahu anhu was wise in a sense that he told Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, I will bring them to justice after the fitna subsides. But Muawiyah radiallahu anhu insisted on his right to ask for the blood of those that killed Uthman radiallahu anhu immediately. But Ali radiallahu anhu was telling him, not now, fitna just happened, let things cool down, give me the bay'ah, because Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was the leader of the Muslims in the Sham. He was the leader of the Mujahideen that, you know, conquered many places. As you will see, Constantinople, which is today in Turkey, was a great fortress under the control of the Romans, and he, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, sent his son Yazid as the leader of the Muslim army to try to conquer Constantinople, but they weren't able to do it. Constantinople would be conquered centuries later by the Ottoman leader, nicknamed Muhammad al-Fatih, Muhammad the Conqueror. So that was a short history of what happened. And because Muawiyah radiallahu anhu did not want to give pledge of allegiance to Ali radiallahu anhu, the two Muslim parties went to war. Aisha radiallahu anha got involved in the problem to try to resolve it. And that's why she traveled to Iraq, of course, with her mahram, so that she can try to make peace between the armies of Ali radiallahu anhu and the army of Muawiyah. But the hypocrites, as usual, they caused fitna, and they were afraid that the Muslims would join forces and stop fighting one another. So what they did is that at night, they start attacking the other army. So the army of Ali radiallahu anhu on one side, and the army of Aisha radiallahu anhu on the other side. So when they caused the fitna, each army thought that the other army betrayed them, because they had agreed earlier in the day to not wage war against one another. But these hypocrites caused the fitna, and you know, basically each army thought the other army betrayed them. So war broke out between them. This is called Mawqi'at al-Jamal, the battle of the camel, which ended by the defeat of Aisha radiallahu anha's army and Abdullah I think it was Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anha was killed in that battle. In any event, after the defeat of the army of Aisha radiallahu anha, Ali radiallahu anha sent Aisha radiallahu anha in a respectful manner back to Medina. Then after that, the army of Ali radiallahu anha fought the army of Muawiyah radiallahu anha. And here you hear that we are saying radiallahu anha twice, because these two parties are believers. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَيْ مِنْ أُنِي اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. If two parties among the believers fight one another, then make peace between them. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that even though these armies are fighting, they are still considered believers, because many people would take the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, "Sibabul mu'mini fusuq wa qitaluhu kufr." To curse a believer is disobedience, and to fight against him is a disbelief. Is a disbelief. Many people will take this as, you know, if two believers fight one another, they are disbelievers. But this isn't the meaning of the hadith. The hadith is that this is an act of the disbelievers, because who fights the believers? It's usually disbelievers who fight the believers. Therefore, if a believer fights another believer, this is an act, this is a disobedience. Because believers are supposed to join forces against the disbelievers, the same way the disbelievers join forces against the believers, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَاتِلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ كَافَّةً كَمَا يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ كَافَّةً. Fight the disbelievers, the polytheists, fight them all the same way that they all fight you. So, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. The disbelievers are helpers and protectors of one another, and the believers are helpers and protectors of one another. إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوا تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ عَظِيمٌ. If you don't do this, if the believers don't join forces with the believers against the disbelievers, then there's going to be a lot of fitna, just like what's happening today. The disbelievers can't defeat the believers in the battlefields. So what do? They collude and collaborate with the hypocrites so that they can help them fight the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. The disbelievers are helpers of one another. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آوَوا وَنَصَرُوا أُولَئِكَ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that those who believe and make hijrah for his sake and make jihad with themselves and their money for the sake of Allah, their wealth for the sake of Allah, and those that give a refuge for the believers and help them fight against disbelievers, those are protectors, awliya, of one another, protectors and helpers of one another. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is in the last page of Surah Al-Anfal, and the disbelievers are helpers and protectors of one another. If you don't do this, if the believers don't help each other, and instead of that, the disbelievers find among the Muslims who help them against the believers, then there's going to be a lot of fitna, wa fasadun kabir, a big tumult and evil in the land, just like what we're seeing today in Palestine. The Mujahideen are fighting against the Jews. They're brothers among the Shia, and of course, as long as they are Muslims, we call them our brothers, irrespective of what the Saudi scholars say because of their political agenda. So their fatwa is political when they say that the Shia, they're not our brothers. Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah says that as long as a party is identified as a Muslim, then war is waged alongside them against the disbelievers. Now someone asks, and someone has asked me, do we join forces with those that insult the Prophet ﷺ and the companions and Aisha radiallahu anha? We tell them that, number one, among the so-called Sunnis, there are people who insult Allah. There are people who insult the Prophet. There are people who do a lot of evil things. So when it comes to war, the fatwa is very clear by the scholars. These differences are put aside. These differences are put aside. As long as they are Muslims, this is the condition. As Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah says, even Sheikh Al-Haydan said, Sheikh Al-Haydan went further. He's like, not only do we join forces with the Muslims in the land that's being attacked by the disbelievers, we even join forces with the disbelievers of that land to push away the invading disbeliever. So don't bring these differences at this point. This isn't the time for it. This is not the time for it. When jihad is on between the Muslims and disbelievers, then all the Muslims, and as we said many times, that the scholars have said that the 72 deviant sects of Muslims all emanate from four deviant sects. First sect is the Shia, second sect is Al-Khawarij, third sect is Al-Murji'ah, fourth sect is Shia Al-Khawarij Wal-Murji'ah. I think it's Qadariya is the fourth one. So all these deviant sects, we are allowed to join forces with them against the disbelievers. The differences are put aside for now. Why? Because they are still considered Muslims. This is the criteria, right? So back to what happened between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, is that the two parties fought, and then the army of Ali radiallahu anhu was winning in the battlefield. So the army of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu put Quran on the heads of the spears and lifted them, telling the army of Ali radiallahu anhu that let the Quran judge between us. Instead of fighting, let the Quran judge between us. Ali radiallahu anhu wanted to continue fighting, but the shura, the close confidence of Ali radiallahu anhu, told him that we needed to submit to the rule of the Quran. So the battle stopped, and this was the reason why the Khawarij first came out. They didn't first come out. Actually, the father of the Khawarij existed at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when this person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him, "I'adil ya Muhammad, be just, O Muhammad." When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was dividing the booty of the Hunain, of the war Hunain, this person came to him and told him to divide the booty justly. Why? Because he did not understand the wisdom and behind the way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam divided the war booty. As a matter of fact, even some of the Ansar did not like that, and they said that, you know, before we gave victory to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now he doesn't need us anymore. But he sallallahu alaihi wasallam clarified to the Ansar that sometimes he gives wealth to people he does not like, but because of maslaha, because of a benefit, there's wisdom behind it. And what he did, alayhi salam, is that he gave a lot of war booty to the heads of the tribes that that were recently that usually turned to Islam. Why? مؤلفة قلوبهم, so that their hearts can remain with Islam, because this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mankind. You know, they like for people to give them things, and this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even made one of the people that can receive zakat al-mal, the mandatory zakat, is مؤلفة قلوبهم, those that just adopted Islam or turned back to Islam. So, and this actually was specifically stated by one of the people that received this. He's like, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most hated person to me on this earth, but he kept on giving me like camels or wealth until he became the most beloved one to me. Because when a person keeps on giving you, keep on looking at him, you know, you of course you say, this person is, you know, he can't be bad, right? Because he's given me so much wealth. So we alayhi salam did that, and this person did not understand the wisdom, so he came to the Prophet and said, i'dil, you know, be just, divide the war booty like correctly or justly. So Umar radiallahu anhu told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let me cut his head. I mean, how can he, this is an act of disbelief for him to think that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not be just. But he alayhi wasallam said, leave him, because from his loins will come out people that will read the Quran, it will not go past their throats. In other words, it's not going to come down to their hearts. Reading the Quran for them is going to be mere recitation. It's not going to impact their hearts correctly. And these are the Khawarij. So this is the reason why the Khawarij showed up, and they were in the thousands. You know, they said Ali radiallahu anhu accepted to give judgment in the matter to people instead of letting Allah judge between us. And they brought the ayah, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is allowed to judge among mankind. So they said Ali radiallahu anhu was a kafir, was a disbeliever. So Ali radiallahu anhu sent Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu to the Khawarij, and he spoke to them and he told them, you know, you say that only Allah's book is to judge between people, not people to judge between people. He told them, how about when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبْعَثُوا حَكَمَ مِنْ أَهْلِهِ وَحَكَمَ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when a husband and wife are having marital problems, send a person from her family and a person from his family so they can be judges. So he, radiallahu anhu, Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, told the Khawarij, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts two men as judges for the private part of a woman, why wouldn't you allow judges among men to deal with the blood of the Muslims whose blood is going to be shed in the battlefield? So thousands of them followed Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and accepted the correct judgment from Ibn Abbas, but thousands others remained as Khawarij, and Ali radiallahu anhu fought them and killed them all. And he was looking for a person among the deceased that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him his characteristics, that he said that these people, they're going to be Khawarij, and there's going to be a person who's, you know, I think his left arm, left or right arm, one of the arms was cut off, and there's a piece of flesh dangling from the arm that looks like the breast of a woman. So he radiallahu anhu sent the people to look for him among the dead. They looked many times, they couldn't find. So he radiallahu anhu went and looked, and finally he found him. So he thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for being on the right side, because of course, you know, he was afraid that, you know, these people would be Muslims and he would have killed him. But these are Khawarij. And as the Prophet ﷺ said, killing them, they are the dogs of hellfire, and there's a lot of reward in killing them, and those that they kill is one of the greatest martyrs. But of course, this Khawarij thing, you know, is being taken out of context by the Saudi scholars today, by the Madakhila specifically. This is actually a deviant current among the Salafis that was spearheaded by Muhammad Aman al-Jami, and after that taken up by Sheikh Rabi' al-Madkhali. Muhammad Aman al-Jami, as Sheikh Nuhaydan said about him, was an Ethiopian guy that wanted to get the Saudi citizenship. So he thought that the best way to do that is to collude and cooperate with the Saudi government against anyone who says anything bad about them, and calling them Khawarij. His name is Muhammad Aman al-Jami. So, you know, basically he tells you that the leader, the ruler of the Muslims is kind of like immune. He's allowed to do anything, and no one is allowed to even speak ill about him. And of course, this is not the true Islamic edict and fatwa, because what you're not allowed to do is pick up weapons, a sword, against a leader who was ruling with Allah's book, Allah's religion, and who is not unjust. But if the leader is either not ruling with Allah's book, or he's being unjust, for example, like what the Saudis today is doing, they're collaborating with the Jews and the Americans, the Christians, to destroy the Saudi youth and women especially. So of course, like this ruler, if someone is able to pick up arms against him and take him out from his rule, whereby he's corrupting the land and he's ruling with the law other than Allah's law, without causing fitna and a lot of killing among the Muslims, then he is supposed to do so. So for example, you know, someone in the castle or among the armies, right? Like coup d'etat, like what happened in Mali, for example, what happened in Burkina Faso, you know, it's like a soft power change. If a person is allowed to do it in Islam, he's supposed to do it. Why? Because this leader is, number one, you know, he's committed a lot of acts of disbelief. He's bringing disbelieving soldiers into the soil of the Muslim lands. This is an act of disbelief, as even their own scholar, Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, said. For you to allow the disbelievers to enter Mecca and Medina, for you to have festivals in the destroyed villages of Thamud, for example, when the Prophet ﷺ said, do not enter them except crying out of awe and fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this person is organizing. So in other words, and the list goes on and on, you know, and he's in prison, any scholar that tells the truth against him. So for me, saying this thing against the ruler, for example, of Saudi Arabia, would be construed by the Madakhila as being a Khawarij, but that's not true. Because I'm not picking up arms, I'm not going against him, but I'm showing the evil he's doing. Perchance he may stop doing it, because if he's doing evil and no one is telling him that what he's doing is evil, then, you know, he's going to go unchecked, right? So therefore, you know, these Jamia that after that, you know, Rabi al-Madkhali took up the banner after Muhammad Amin al-Jami, they are saying this thing. They're telling you that, you know, the ruler is off limits. You know, as one of them said, that if he comes out on national television every day committing zina openly in a half hour, you know, for a half hour every day on television, you're not allowed to say anything against him. I mean, we tell them. I mean, no religion and no logic tells you that that's allowed. I mean, even the kuffar. I mean, look at the kuffar, for example, in the U.S., Bill Clinton basically had an affair with Monica Lewinsky in private, and still he's impeached and his. So you're telling me that you, as a Muslim, you can see this munkar in front of your eyes openly, and then you don't even say something bad about it? This is really atrociously idiotic, right? It has nothing to do with religion. You know, no religion would tell you to do that. No, when you see evil, you have to speak. You have to speak about it, because Prophet ﷺ said that there are gonna come rulers after me. He said in hadith, there's going to come rulers after me. They're going to do good things and bad things. Those that make inkar, that means they speak about this evil thing that's happened, saying this is wrong, you're not supposed to do this. And those who at least hate that in their hearts are safe from Allah's punishment. But those who follow these rulers, like these madakhila are the ones who are bound to be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these madakhila are doing like what the Jews and Christians did. They changed the religion to please the princes and the rulers. And this is what the madakhila are doing now. But of course, Alice, they won't go far, because this religion is protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what happened to the Jews and Christians is not going to happen to this ummah. There's always going to be a part among this ummah who is fighting jihad for the sake of Allah. Like in the battlefield, as we see, you know, brothers in Gaza, in Jenin, in Lebanon, in Yemen, in Iraq, in Syria, and other brothers who are waging jihad with their tongues, other brothers who are waging jihad, you know, softly in mass media, etc. So all these are types of jihad for the sake of Allah. And of course, the one thing that the Saudi scholars say is that, you know, don't trust the Shia. They openly tell you that they are opposing the Jews and the Americans, but they are secretly colluding and cooperating with them. Now, you know, personally, I fell for this argument for many years. But then, after the war in Gaza happened, I was shocked to see that the Emiratis and the Saudis and the Jordanians and the Egyptians are openly colluding and cooperating with the Jews and Americans, openly. So at least if the Shia are doing this secretly, at least they have some shame. When you talk about these people, I mean, they're Sunni. They claim they are Sunnis, but they're hypocrites. They are apostates. And they are apostates. This is what the scholar said. Anyone that helps a disbelieving nation who is fighting the Muslims against the Muslims is a disbeliever. He's an apostate. I mean, there is no difference of opinion about this matter. So, you know, back to, you know, we started this by talking about the Khawarij because, you know, these Madakhila, anyone who goes against their misguided current of deifying their rulers, turn him into a god, like what they did to Fir'aun, they call him a Khawarij. But that's not who the Khawarij are. The Khawarij are the ones that started Ali radiallahu anhu. Anyway, the Khawarij are the ones that were at the time of Ali radiallahu anhu. The ones that come after them are called al-Bughat, the ones, who, the aggressors. So the Khawarij were killed by Ali radiallahu anhu. And after that, Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah agreed to do a pact that Muawiyah would remain the ruler of Hisham and Ali radiallahu anhu would remain the ruler of the other parts of the Muslim land. And if anyone among the two dies first, the other one would become a Khalifa. Ali radiallahu anhu was killed by a Khariji. So this is a Khawarij because he killed Ali ibn Abi Talib, you know, because they're saying that, oh, Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah are the causes of the of spilling the blood of the Muslims, so let's kill them and rid the people from their evil. But of course, this was the wrong conclusion. Ali radiallahu anhu was killed. Muawiyah was not killed. After Ali radiallahu anhu was killed, Al-Hasan, his son, who's the elder one, became the Khalifa. And then we had, again, two rulers, one in Hisham by Muawiyah and Al-Hasan. And that's when Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu seceded the Khilafah to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu so that the Muslims can stop fighting and killing each other. And this was called the year of Al-Jama'ah, the year of the unison. And that's why today you see the Shia, they are not happy with Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu because he seceded the throne to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And they deify Al-Husayn because he radiallahu anhu fought for the truth, fought to become the Khalifa. And we, the Sunnis, the true position of the Sunnis is what we'll see here in Tafsir ibn Kathir, is that we love al-Husayn, radiallahu anhu. He's the grandson of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How can anyone hate al-Husayn, radiallahu anhu? How can anyone be happy with the death of al-Husayn? You know, the hypocrites and the Jews, by the way, they come out with a lot of lies that they spread among the Sunnis about the Shia and among the Shia about the Sunnis. So the lie, one of the lies that is spread among the Shia is that the Sunnis in Ashura, the day that Husayn was killed, they are happy. They fast because they are happy and they thank Allah because Husayn was killed. And this is, of course, logically speaking, not even religiously speaking, doesn't make sense. How can a person claim to be a Muslim if he is happy with something that makes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sad? You think the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would like for his grandson to be killed by his own ummah? Of course not. That's why he alayhi salam, when he was coming back from one of the expeditions, you know, by a well of called Ghadir Khum, he told the people, I left in you two things, the book of Allah and my family members, and my family members, and my family members. Because he, alayhi salatu wasalam, knew that the fitna was going to happen. He told Ali radiallahu anhu that Hussein radiallahu anhu would be killed in Karbala. And it's called Karbala because it's the concatenation of two words, Karb wa Bala. Karbun wa Bala, Karbala. Karb is sadness, bala is a trial. So the killing of Hussein al-Dayan was an evil thing that happened to this ummah. And the ones who killed him, as you will see, they were acting out of their own evil souls. out of their own evil desires and out of their own mind. You know, Yazid bin Muawiyah was not the one to tell them to kill him. Yazid was the ruler, and it was obvious for him to try to defend his kingdom, the same way the kings today are defending their kingdoms by killing hundreds of thousands, or I don't know how many. I mean, just look at, we gave the example of Saudi Arabia. How many scholars are in jail? How many are killed? Why? Because people want to hang on to the throne. So does that mean that, for example, what the ruler of Saudi Arabia is doing today, does that mean that this is the position of the Sunnis? Of course not. Of course not. I mean, he may claim to be a Sunni. I mean, he may be an apostate because of the actions that he undertook. He may do something against the Shia. He may do something for the benefit of the Jews, the benefit of the Americans. But does that mean that all the Sunnis are in the same position and they condone that action? Of course not. Therefore, in this time of trial, in this time of war, where the Western world is coming to the help of the Jews so that they can annihilate a small group of Mujahideen in Gaza, the Muslims have to come back to the truth, have to put the differences aside. Sunnis and Shia and Khawarij and any sect, as long as he is a Muslim, they are to join forces against the disbelievers. Not only that, but also the disbelievers themselves who are protesting in universities, protesting in non-Muslim land. Those two, they are in the fight for the truth. As Sheikh Luhaidan said, we can even join forces with non-Muslims against this invading kafir. So the same way that the non-Muslims in you know, Western universities are supporting our brothers, the Mujahideen, why would you think that it's not right for us to join forces with the Shia against the Jews and Christians? Of course, it doesn't make sense. You know, who's worse? Is it Shia or disbeliever? Of course, the disbeliever. Disbeliever, you know, is in hellfire forever and ever. The Shia, as Sheikh Al-Bani Rahimahullah said, you cannot make a blanket statement about them that they are kuffar. This is the opinion of Sheikh Al-Bani Rahimahullah. Now, the Saudi scholars, they said, no, they are all Shia, and yet they allow them to go to Hajj. So this is a conundrum. If they are disbelievers, why are you allowing them to make Hajj, right? So which means that you yourselves know that they are not disbelievers. So the Shia, according to each person's belief, as Sheikh Al-Bani Rahimahullah said, and Sheikh Al-Bani clarified that this does not only apply to the Shia, it also applies to the Sunnis. Wallahi, this is Sheikh Al-Bani said, you know, subhanAllah, he was one of the scholars of this ummah that saw things clearly. He said, for you to come and make a blanket statement about the Shia, they're all kuffar, he said, you cannot make a blanket statement about the Sunnis that they are all Muslims. So each Shia, each person is either a believer or disbeliever based on what he believes and based on what he says. Similarly for the Sunnis. I mean, the hypocrites today who are helping the Jews and Christians, who are they? Are they among the Shia? No, they're among the Sunnis. So are we going to say that all the Sunnis are apostates because some rulers among them are committing acts of apostasy? No. Therefore, at this stage, when the Ummah is divided, when the Ummah is being killed by the millions, in Iraq, in Lebanon, in Syria, in Libya, in Chad, in Yemen, at this stage, the differences have to be put aside among the Muslims. And this actually happened at the time of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. You know, when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was fighting with Ali radiallahu anhu, the Christian king thought that the Muslims are busy fighting each other. So he tried to invade some land that has been ruled by the Muslims. So Muawiyah radiallahu anhu sent him a letter say, listen to me, all you dog of the Christians. This is how Muslims used to deal with the Christians. They used to call them dogs. Their kings are dogs. They used to call their kings dogs. And they wouldn't say a single thing. He said, listen to me, you dog of the Christians. If you don't cease and desist, I shall make peace with my brother, Ali radiallahu anhu, and we shall come to you and invade you in your own home. So when the Christian king received the letter, he backed off. Because the disbelievers take advantage of the divisions among the Muslims. And this is why the Saudis were put in there. The Al-Saud were put as caretakers of the Holy Land by the British in the beginning after the Americans, so that they can use the Sunnis as proxies to fight the American war against the Shia. I repeat, the Saudi rulers were put by the British first, and the Americans after them, first against Sharif al-Hussein, who collaborated with the with Britain against the Ottoman Empire, because they promised him to give him the kingdom of the Arabs, but then after they betrayed him, as is always as they always do, but then when he saw that they were betrayed, that he was betrayed, he stopped collaborating with the British, and he declared himself a Khalifa. So when he declared himself Khalifa, the British gave weapons and money to Al Saud, and they brought them from the Kuwait so that they can wage war against Sharif al-Hussein, and then they became the rulers of Saudi Arabia. So these are pawns of the disbelievers. And then the Saudis and their scholars have become the right hand puppet master. The puppet master, the puppets are the Sunnis, who are being moved by the puppet master, who are the Saudi scholars backed by the Americans, to do what? To wage war against the Shia. We have to understand, brothers, you know, if you look at history, what happened in Lebanon, what happened in Yemen, what happened in Syria, what happened in Iraq, you have to understand that the Sunnis are being used by the Americas and the Jews to fight a dirty war against the Shia. I repeat that. The Sunnis are being used, are being manipulated. Hatred is thrust into their hearts. Hatred of the Shia is thrust into their hearts, so that the Sunnis can fight the Shia. And then they bring some verses. They are the real enemy, talking about the Shia. Why? Because this falls into the benefit of the Americans and the Jews. If someone tells me that this is only an act of Hollywood act between the Shia and the Americans and the Jews, I ask you, why are the Americans and the Jews killing the top generals of the Shia? Like Soleimani, for example, why did they kill him? Well, if it's an act, they may just, you know, put a bomb somewhere in the desert and say, we bombed them. No, these are top IRGC commanders that are being killed by the Americans and the Jews. Why? Because they are really their enemies. Truly, they are enemies. This is what we see with our own eyes. And truly, the Saudis, the Emiratis, and the Sunni despots are the ones who are being controlled by the Jews and Christians. This is the sad truth, but this is something we see in front of our eyes. The Houthis, who are Shia, are bombing the ships that are going to the state of the Jews. I'll call it Israel, just so people can know what I'm talking about. So the Houthis are bombing the ships who are going to Israel. And then the Saudis and the Emiratis and the Jordanians, they are telling the Jews, come, we will help you. Let us give you a land corridor for us to bring you the goods that the Houthis are stopping you from receiving. So how can you tell me that the Shia are colluding with the Jews secretly, when openly we see that it's the Sunnis who are given what the Jews need for their daily livelihoods instead of the Shia? So, you know, we really can't be that this stupid, right? You know, in Islam, we don't worship our scholars like the Jews do. The Jews worship their scholars, because the Prophet ﷺ said, if 10 among the scholars of the Jews follow me, they become Muslims, all the Jews would follow me. But I'm not like that. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The scholars are only there to clarify some religious matters to us. If they are on the truth, we follow them. If they are not on the truth, we follow those who are on the truth. So back here, we went off course talking about the Khawarij. But we need to clarify that. So back to Tafsir ibn Kathir. His name was Al-Husayn bin Ali bin Abi Talib bin Abdul Muttalib bin Hashim Abu Abdullah Al-Qurashi Al-Hashimi, the son of the Prophet ﷺ's daughter Fatima al-Zahra, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the Raihan of the world of the Prophet ﷺ. Al-Qatada states that Al-Husayn was born 6 years and 5.5 months after the Hijrah. He, radiallahu anhu, was killed on a Friday, on the day of Ashura, which is the 10th day of Islamic month of Muharram, which is coming up in a few days, in the 61st year. So 61 years after Hijrah, he was killed, radiallahu anhu. He was aged 54 years and 6.5 months, because obviously he was born 6 years after Hijrah. So 6 plus 54 is 61. He was 54 and he was killed on the 61st year of Hijrah. It is narrated that the Messenger of Allah made dua for him to be blessed with wisdom and experience. and had rubbed his blessed saliva, that is the saliva of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, put his saliva in the mouth of Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu while supplicating for him. So the pure saliva of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when it was swallowed by Husayn radiallahu anhu, it had the greatest impact on him, and it is he sallallahu alaihi wasallam who named him with this name Al-Husayn. Anas is reported to have said, I was with Ibn Ziyad when the head of Al-Husayn was brought to him. We will see Ibn Ziyad was the ruler of Al-Kufa, and he was an evildoer that even Yazid ibn Muawiyah was about to take away the rule of Al-Kufa from him until he heard that the ruler of Al-Kufa was going to collaborate with Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu against him. So he took away the rule of the Kufa and he gave it to Ibn Ziyad. So Anas radiallahu anhu was with Ibn Ziyad when the head of Al-Husayn was brought to him, because after they killed him, they cut off his head radiallahu anhu. Ibn Ziyad started poking at the nose and mouth of Al-Husayn with a stick. He was evil, subhanAllah. Upon which, he, Ibn Ziyad, made some reference to his handsome features. So Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was handsome. So Anas said to him, Al-Husayn resembled the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than the others did. So in his face, radiallahu anhu, Al-Husayn, he looked a lot like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Husayn was a contemporary of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and despite being so young, he was a companion whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was pleased with until his death. After that, As-Siddiq Abu Bakr treated Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu with the same way by honoring and respecting Al-Husayn, as did Umar and Uthman radiallahu anhum. He was a companion of his father Ali radiallahu anhu. He would narrate a hadith on the authority of his father Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. And he, Husayn radiallahu anhu, participated in all of the invasions with Ali radiallahu anhu, with his father, specifically in the battles of Al-Jamal, as we said, the one against the army led by Aisha radiallahu anha, and the Battle of Siffin, which was against the army of Muawiyah radiallahu anha. So the introduction that we gave was necessary for us to understand what is meant here by the Battles of Jamal and Siffin. As a result, when his brother Al-Hasan radiallahu anha gave up the Khilafah, as we explained earlier, and sought to reconcile matters with Muawiyah radiallahu anha so that the Muslims can have a single leader, Al-Husayn was greatly troubled and urged his brother to go to war with the people of Hashem, because he thought that they are more entitled to be in Khulafa than Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. This is ijtihad, and you know, he had his own reasons to do that. We can't say it's right, we can't say it's wrong. As a matter of fact, many companions wanted to become Khalifa, and there's nothing wrong with that, right? And obviously, you know, the reason why they want to become Khalifa is not for them to accumulate wealth and collaborate with the Jews and Christians as the rulers today do. They wanted to do that to benefit the Ummah, because the rulers in this Ummah, the Khulafa, are usually supposed to be scholars in the religion. This is the biggest criteria, is Salahuddin, is that their religion has to be great. Umar radiallahu anhu, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Uthman, these were scholars in the religion. Ali radiallahu anhu, they were scholars. So the ruler of the Muslims has to be a scholar. Why? Because scholar is the one that fears Allah the most. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ عُلَمَا. Surely among mankind, it is the scholars, the religious scholars, not the scholars of physics or chemistry. The religious scholars are the ones that fear Allah the most. So when a person fears Allah, he's going to do justice in the people that he rules over. So this should be the criteria, and the proof for that is what is in Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Talut as king for the Jews. The Jews said, how can he be king, you know, when we are more deserving to be kings because of our lineage, and he does not have as much money as we do. Because since the day of the Jews, even before Isa alayhi salam, the Jews, this was their criteria to become rulers, just like today. You have to have money, and you have to be from a known, well-known family. But this is not the criteria that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to give kingdom to his slaves. As there in Surah Al-Baqarah, the criteria that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses to give kingdom to his people, or actually, this is the criteria that we people should use to select rulers, زَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمُ وَالْجِسْمِ. Talut had physical strength, so he can wage jihad for the sake of Allah, not be afraid of the enemies and give them the Muslim land for free because he's afraid to fight them. So physical strength and knowledge. He's more knowledgeable than others. Basta. Basta, that means additional. Additional knowledge compared to other people, additional physical strength compared to other people. So that's the way that Muslims chose the Khulafa in the beginning. It was a shura, it was a consultation among the companions, and they chose the one that was fittest to rule the Muslims. But after that, you know, kingdoms came, and after that, dictatorships came. And as a result, you see how the Muslim matters is. The Muslim societies are disintegrating from within because evil has become rampant among them, and the laws are being enacted to protect evil and fight against goodness, and armies are being used to defend this evil. So in any event, Al-Hussein wanted to be the Khalifa, of course, under the consultation of the other companions, actually, he wanted Al-Hasan to remain a Khalifa, but Hasan radiallahu anhuma, through his wisdom, thought that it's best for him to give up the Khilafah for the sake of preserving Muslim blood. So in spite of his reluctance, however, once Muawiyah radiallahu anhu assumed the Khilafah, Al-Husayn basically gave him allegiance and would frequently visit Muawiyah with his brother Al-Hasan. And Muawiyah radiallahu anhuma, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu anhuma, would show them great hospitality and honor in return. Following Al-Hassan's death, Al-Husayn would travel to see Muawiyah every year, who would generously present him with kind gestures and treat him with great esteem. After all, Muawiyah ibn Anhu was a companion who was one of the people that wrote the Quran for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he treated Al-Husayn, who was the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, greatly, because anyone who loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would love Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn and Al al-Bayt, all of them, and all the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in the hearts of the believers. So he was in the army. Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was in the army that invaded Al-Qustantiniyya under the commandership of Muawiyah's son. So when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was Khalifa, he sent the army to conquer Constantinople, and the leader of the army was his own son, Yazid bin Muawiyah. And among the soldiers of Yazid bin Muawiyah was Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu, and this happened in the 51st year of Hijrah. When Muawiyah died in the 60th year of Hijrah, an allegiance was pledged to Yazid. As the scholars said, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu also thought that for him to preserve the blood of the Muslims, let him assign the Khilafah to his son after him. And many of the Sahaba confirmed that choice, but not all of them. Not all of them confirmed that choice. So when Muawiyah died in the 60th year of Hijrah, and allegiance, al-Bay'ah, was given to his son Yazid, Ibn Abbas and Ibn Umar offered their pledges, their Bay'ah. So Ibn Abbas and Ibn Umar offered their Bay'ah to Yazid bin Muawiyah. As we said, some companions, scholars among companions, like Ibn Umar and Abbas, they are scholars. And they gave Bay'ah to Yazid and disputed with Al-Husayn and Ibn Zubayr, who did not give Bay'ah. So Ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhuma, and then Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhuma, did not give the Pledge of Allegiance to Yazid ibn Muawiyah. And then Husayn radiallahu anhu left al-Madinah and went to reside in Mecca. In Mecca, the people devoted themselves to al-Husayn radiallahu anhu by visiting him frequently. Of course, he was the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a scholar. He looked the most like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they used to sit around him. They used to attentively listen to what he had to say about Muawiyah's death and Yazid's assumption of power. In other words, Husayn radiallahu anhu disagreed with the assumption of the assumption of power by Yazid, because he radiallahu anhu Husayn wanted the matter to remain as a shura among the Muslims, as opposed to it being inherited. But as we said, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu wanted to preserve the blood of the Muslims, and other scholars among the Sahaba agreed to that. And as we saw, Ibn Abbas and Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma gave the pledge to Yazid ibn Muawiyah. As for Ibn Zubayr, who did not give bay'ah either to Yazid ibn Muawiyah, and we'll see later that he was killed by Hajjaj bin Yusuf. So Ibn Zubayr would remain at his place of prayer by the Kaaba, despite the fact that delegations and military detachments had been dispatched to Mecca by Yazid ibn Muawiyah to capture Ibn Zubayr. Nonetheless, Allah granted him victory over them, so he fought these small armies and defeated them, and defeated whomever else desired his death among the supporters of Yazid, including the brother of Abdullah bin Zubayr, whose name was Umar. So Umar was the brother of Abdullah bin Zubayr, and was on the side of Yazid bin Muawiyah, but Ibn Zubayr beat him and imprisoned him, an act for which he later became renowned. However, in spite of all of this, he was not heralded. That means Ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu was not heralded by the people in the same manner as Al-Husayn, because even though he was a companion, and as a matter of fact, Abdullah bin Zubayr radiallahu anhu was the first baby to be born in Medina after Hijrah. Because after Hijrah, like Muslims would not give birth to children. So they started asking, is this, you know, does this have something to do with our Hijrah, etc., etc.? So they were worried, you know, that they would have no children born to them in Medina. But he, Abdullah bin Zubayr, was the first one to be born, and he was taken to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He made dua for him. And Az-Zubayr, his father, was the husband of Asma, the sister of Aisha radiallahu anha. So Abdullah bin Zubayr, his mother is Asma bint Abi Bakr, Asma, the sister of Aisha radiallahu anha. So Abdullah bin Zubayr was not heralded by the people in the same manner as Al-Husayn, because Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was regarded as a noble person due to his relation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the door of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Fatima radiallahu anha. So even though during that time there was nobody on the face of the earth who was superior to Al-Husayn in status or in blood lineage, or who could even be considered equal to him, the entire Yazidid state opposed him. They opposed him. Why? Because he was a threat to them. He was a threat to them, to their rule. Because some people want kingdom of this world and others want the kingdom of the hereafter. In contrast, letters and messages came frequently from Al-Iraq to Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu, inviting him to go to them so that they can support him and they can wage war against Yazid, because the people of Iraq did not give the pledge of allegiance to Yazid bin Muawiyah. So here, even though Muawiyah radiallahu anhu wanted to gather the word of the Muslims under a single ruler, that did not happen. The people of Iraq did not give the pledge of allegiance to Yazid, and they sent letters to Husayn radiallahu anhu so that he can go to them, so that they can help him fight against the people of the Sham, the same way they did with Ali radiallahu anhu, as we stated before, in the Battle of Saffin. Now, as the letters began to accumulate and the messages continued to arrive to Al-Husayn, the people of Iraq increasingly urged Al-Husayn to go to them so that they could pledge their allegiance to him, give him the bay'ah, in place of Yazid bin Muawiyah, since they had not yet pledged allegiance to anyone. Of course, we'll see later, you know, we're going to fast forward that when he goes to them, they're gonna let him down. You know, they're telling him, come. And then when he went to them, they backed off and they left him alone, radiallahu anhu, to be killed alongside his family members. So why would the Sunnis be blamed for this? How would the Sunnis be blamed for this, right? As a matter of fact, at that point, there was no Sunnis and Shias. They were all single sect Muslims. They were the Khawarij among them. So those people that called Hussein to come to them and let him down, those are the ones to be blamed. But are you going to call them that they are the Sunnis? No, they are not. You can't say that they're Sunnis. At that point, there was no division yet between Sunnis and Shia. Those are evil people who betrayed Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu. As a matter of fact, you know, I'm sorry to say this to our brothers in Iraq, but there's a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that, you know, says that the fitna always comes from the east, which is the Iraq. And there's another hadith that says the maradatu shayateen, the greatest shayateen, devils reside in Iraq. These are hadith. So that land is known throughout history with a lot of fitna that comes from it. So those people, they betrayed al-Husayn. They told him, come to us, we'll give you the pledge of allegiance, because we didn't pledge allegiance to Yazid. We're not convinced that he should be a Khalifa. Come and we'll fight alongside with you against him. But when he came to them, as we'll see later, they let him be killed at the hands of a few evil people that wanted dunya instead of the hereafter. So eventually al-Husayn decided to send his paternal cousin, Muslim bin Aqil bin Abi Talib, to al-Iraq to determine the nature of the matter and its credibility. So basically he sent his cousin to figure out if the people are truly with him and that they're not gonna let him down. Now upon departing from Mecca, Muslim bin Aqil, the cousin of Hussein radiallahu anhu, passed through al-Medina in order to obtain two witnesses to take with him on the desolate road. So basically it's a desolate road between Medina and Iraq, through the desert, etc. So he took two witnesses with him to witness the fact that the people of Iraq gave the pledge of allegiance to al-Husayn radiallahu anhu, so that these witnesses can go back to the Medina and spread the news that al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was given pledge of allegiance by Iraq, so that they too can give pledge of allegiance, people might give pledge of allegiance, and then only the Sham is going to remain. And you know, this was the plan, right? This was the plan. So he took two witnesses with him, but in the middle of the journey, look, Qadarullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that all this happened. In the middle of the journey, however, one of the witnesses was lost in the desert, and then after that he fled. Well, the other witness died from the harsh conditions of the desert. So the two witnesses died, so no one would be able to go back with the news to Medina. In due course, Muslim arrived in Al-Kufa alone. And upon his arrival, he allegedly stayed with a man called Muslim bin Awsaja al-Asadi. Muslim bin Awsaja al-Asadi. So this is who Muslim bin Aqil stayed with. So soon enough, word spread among the people of Al-Kufa that Muslim had arrived. And so they went to him, pledging their allegiance to al-Husayn, as well as vowing to assist him by means of their own selves and their wealth. So basically they give bay'ah to Husayn, saying we're going to fight with him, with ourselves and our wealth. The number of people who agreed to pledge allegiance to him numbered approximately 12,000. Look how many people pledged allegiance in the beginning, which later increased to somewhere around 18,000 people who pledged allegiance to Husayn radiallahu anhu. Accordingly, Muslim bin Aqil wrote to al-Husayn, affirming to him that, you know, the news is correct, that the people of Iraq are with you, they're giving you pledge of allegiance, so you should come to Iraq so that, you know, you can ask for the Khilafah, because you are more worthy of it. And if Yazid does not secede the throne, then war is to break out between the two parties. So he assured him of the validity of the allegiance of the people of Iraq, and that he would make the necessary arrangements. That means Muslim bin Aqil would make the necessary arrangements for the arrival of al-Husayn. Immediately, al-Husayn embarked on the journey from Mecca to al-Kufa, which then became widespread knowledge that reached even the governor of al-Kufa, al-Nu'man bin Bashir, who in turn said, I do not wage war against whomever does not wage war against me. That means al-Nu'man bin Bashir was with al-Husayn. And he said that I'm not gonna wage war against him, nor do I ambush whomever does not ambush me. So even though An-Nu'man bin Bashir was the governor under Yazid bin Muawiyah, he too thought that al-Husayn is more deserving of the Khilafah than Yazid, because Yazid bin Muawiyah was known to do a lot of evil things. So that's why we said, if these madakhila tell us that anyone that speaks bad against a ruler because he does evil things, why did these early generations of the greatest Muslims, as the Prophet said, that the first three generations, thought that Yazid did not deserve to be a Khalifa because he was an evildoer. He's an evildoer, committing evil that only concerns him, let alone be an apostate and bring in the disbelievers into Muslim land. So not only did they speak against him, they even picked up arms against him. Husayn radiallahu anhu picked up arms against Yazid bin Muawiyah. So you're telling me that al-Husayn is a Khariji, is from the Khawarij? Of course not. Khariji is the one that picks up arms against a good ruler that rules according to Allah's book and is doing just among the people. But if a ruler is evil, doesn't rule with Allah's book, or rules with Allah's book, but then commits acts of apostasies and collaborates with the disbelievers, then you know, basically, if a party among the Muslims is able to take him out and put another leader that is more in accordance with the Sharia, then they should do that. Because if they leave this evil leader in control of the land, he's going to corrupt that land once and again. And this is why the disbelievers, they chose some young rulers in Saudi Arabia and in the Emirates to put them as rulers, because these people were never to be the rulers of those lands unless they had either killed or imprisoned the ones who were supposed to be prince inheritors of the throne, just like what happened in the Emirates. Two of the brothers of bin Zayd were trapped by Muhammad bin Zayd, MBZ. Muhammad bin Zayd was actually the third one in third in line to be the ruler of the Emirates, but he somehow managed to catch his older brother, who was the prince inheritor, committing some evil acts, and he showed that to his father, who took him out from being the prince inheritor and put the second son as prince inheritor. And then after the second son became the ruler, somehow he became crazy. He became crazy somehow, and then after that, Muhammad bin Zayd became the ruler. So basically, he sold his soul to the devil, to the West, to the Jews, to the Christians, and they helped him become the ruler. The same way MBS, Muhammad bin Salman, was not to be the prince inheritor. The one that was to be the prince inheritor is Muhammad bin Nayef. But then somehow, you know, the same way that happened in the Emirates, they filmed him, you know, committing a lot of evil acts with alcohol, drugs, and women. And Muhammad bin Salman showed those videos to his father, King Salman, who told Muhammad bin Nayef either secede the prince inheritance job or position, or I will expose your evil to the Saudi ruling family. So Muhammad bin Nayef did that, and then Muhammad bin Salman became the prince inheritor, and according to the news, Muhammad bin Nayef became a drug addict somehow, either by force or by consent, so that he can never become a threat to Muhammad bin Salman. So, you know, these are things that we have to explain, because a person may not understand why these people are selling their souls to the devil. Why are they selling the Muslim holy land to the disbelievers? That's because they wanted to be rulers. They wanted to be rulers, and they were not the ones to rule unless they made a pact with the devil to sell their souls and sell the Muslim land to the disbelievers. And obviously here, when we go back to our book, we're talking about Yazid bin Muawiyah, we're talking about Ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad wanted the worldly life, and basically he was hateful and did not respect the fact that Hussein was the grandson of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and basically he killed him. And did the disbelievers a great favor by dividing the Muslims into two major sects that are fighting each other until today. I speak about the Sunnis and Shias, who are fighting proxy wars in Lebanon, in Iraq, in Syria, in Yemen, and in other places. So immediately, al-Husayn embarked on the journey from Mecca to al-Kufa, which then became widespread knowledge that reached even the governor of al-Kufa, Namad bin Bashir, who in turn said, "I do not wage war against whomever does not wage war against me, nor do I ambush whomever does not ambush me." Because as we said, he was not in agreement with what Yazid bin Muawiyah was doing. On the other hand, Abdullah bin Muslim bin Shu'bah al-Hadrami went to Nu'man bin Bashir and said to him, "This course of action that you are pursuing," that means, you know, letting al-Husayn scot-free and not attacking him, even though you are the leader of al-Kufa, he said, "This is the course of the weak and feeble." So Nu'man bin Bashir radiallahu anhu replied, "That is because I am weak. That means because I am weak in obedience to Allah. Do you want me to be one of the strong and great in disobedience to Allah?" In other words, he's telling him, "Yeah, okay, I'm weak and feeble in obedience to Allah. I don't do a lot of good acts. So do you want me to be strong in disobedience to Allah by killing the grandson of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?" Upon hearing of Nu'man's response, Yazid gave orders for his dismissal. Because obviously Yazid bin Muawiyah did not like the fact that his own governor would not protect his kingdom. So he dismissed Nu'man bin Bashir from al-Kufa. And again, these rulers, the governors of Nu'man bin Bashir, Nu'man bin Bashir was a companion, right? So these are rulers who feared Allah. So they would not go and help injustice. This is why the Muslims will never go back to the greatness that they used to be on unless the ones who are ruling them are religious scholars. There are people who know the things about dunya, but they have enough or great knowledge about the religion, as opposed to them being ignorant of the religion, or at least if they don't know a lot about the religion, they need to be surrounded by real scholars who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and undertake their opinions that these scholars that fear Allah give these rules. So upon hearing An-Nu'man's response, Yazid bin Muawiyah gave orders for the dismissal of An-Nu'man from the governorship of Al-Kufa. And he decided to merge Al-Kufa with Al-Basra under the governorship of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. Even though Yazid hated Ubaidullah bin Ziyad and was actually on the verge of dismissing him from Al-Basra. So this drastic move by Yazid was undertaken primarily for his own protection and security, even though Yazid hated Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. So Yazid bin Muawiyah, radiyallahu anhu Muawiyah, hated Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. And by the way, the scholars of Sunnah, they said, as far as Yazid is concerned, we don't love him, we don't hate him. You know, he is among the Muslims, he did good deeds, he did bad deeds, as we saw before. He was among the army that conquered Constantinople, and the Prophet ﷺ said a hadith that those that conquered Constantinople, their sins are forgiven. So we leave his matter with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the same way that we leave the matter of Al-Hajjaj bin Yusuf to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, they're not apostates, as far as the scholars said. So even though Yazid hated Ubaidullah bin Ziyad, who he originally planned to dismiss from the governorship of Al-Basra, he ended up entrusting with him authority over both Al-Basra and Al-Kufa, as was the will of Allah. Why? Because Ubaidullah bin Ziyad was evil enough to be able to carry out the protection of the throne of Yazid bin Muawiyah against Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu. So this is a collaboration based on maslaha, based on benefit. So Yazid hated Ubaidullah bin Ziyad, but he gave him the governorship of Al-Basra and Al-Kufa so that he can protect him from Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu. So soon after, Yazid wrote to Ibn Ziyad saying, when you arrive in Al-Kufa, seek out Muslim bin Aqil, the cousin of Al-Husayn, and suppress him by either killing or humiliating him. Accordingly, Ibn Ziyad traveled from Al-Basra to Al-Kufa, where he resided at the royal palace. Basically, Bashir was taken out from there because he was no longer the ruler. Once he had established his authority there, he then sent a slave called Maqil of the Banu Tamim tribe with 3,000 dirhams destined for the city of Hims in central Syria, so that Maqil could take the money to the house in which Muslim bin Aqil was taking the pledges of allegiance from the people. So this was a spy. So Maqil, the slave called Maqil, was a spy sent by Ibn Ziyad for him to gather the news about what's happening around the cousin of Al-Husayn. So this slave was to say that he had come to offer his pledge of allegiance so that they can give him access to Muslim bin Aqil so that he can gather news on what's happening there. So upon arriving there, the slave Maqil offered his pledge of allegiance to Al-Husayn. So he was let in to see Muslim bin Aqil, who subsequently kept him there for a number of days until the slave demonstrated his sincerity. After that, the slave left from there and returned to Ubaidullah bin Ziyad and informed him of the whereabouts of the house where Muslim bin Aqil was residing and who was there. So this was a spy. So meanwhile, Muslim bin Aqil moved to the house of Hani bin Urwa al-Muradi, and then a second time to the house of Shariq bin al-A'war, one of the senior chiefs who had been informed that Ubaidullah was pursuing Muslim bin Aqil. So this Shariq wanted to protect the cousin of Al-Husayn. Upon hearing this, he sent a message to Hani saying, Ibn Ziyad sent a message to Hani saying, send Muslim bin Aqil to me so that he may kill. This isn't Ibn Ziyad that said this. This is Shariq that sent a message to Hani. So this is Shariq sent a message to Hani, telling Hani, send Muslim bin Aqil to me so that he may kill Ubaidullah bin Ziyad in my house if he happens to come here looking for Muslim bin Aqil. So if Ubaidullah comes looking for Muslim bin Aqil, Muslim bin Aqil is going to kill him in my own house. This is what Hani, this is what Shariq said to Hani. Thus, Hani sent Muslim bin Aqil to the house of Shariq, who said to Muslim bin Aqil, he said, go and stay in the tent outside so that when Ubaidullah bin Ziyad comes in, I will ask for some water to be fetched. So he will ask for water. This was going to be a sign for you to come so this will be my sign, my cue to you to come in and kill Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. Okay, so this is Shariq speaking to Muslim bin Aqil, who is the cousin of Al-Husayn. So Shariq told Muslim bin Aqil, when Ubaidullah bin Ziyad comes to my house, I will ask for water. When you hear that, you, Muslim bin Aqil, come and kill Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. Sure enough, Ubaidullah bin Ziyad arrived at the house of Shariq and sat down on his couch, at which point Shariq shouted, bring me some water, drink. That means he's telling Muslim bin Aqil, come and kill Ibn Ziyad. Reluctant to take action, Muslim backed down from killing him. So he did not go along with the plan. Muslim did not go along with the plan. And as the slave girl entered the tent with a small jug of water because she heard her master asking for water, she found Muslim bin Aqil in a nervous state. So she got afraid and she quickly ran out. Shariq repeated his instruction 3 times, at which point Ubaidullah quickly realized that he was being set up, because a person asking for water 3 times and no one comes in, something is not kosher, as the statement goes. So Ubaidullah bin Ziyad quickly realized that he was being set up and signaled to his guard that he had with him that they should leave immediately, which they did. So Shariq said to Muslim, what prevented you from coming in and killing Ubaidullah bin Ziyad? So Muslim bin Shariq said, I heard the hadith in which the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, faith has prevented treacherous assassination. Faith has prevented treacherous assassination. So Muslim bin Aqil remembered the hadith and he did not want to kill Ubaidullah treacherously, even though he himself was under the threat of being killed. The hadith says, faith has prevented treacherous assassination. A believer does not commit treacherous assassination. So Muslim says, thus I detested the idea of conniving to kill him in your house. At this point, Shariq said, even if you had killed him while sitting in the palace, nobody would have prepared him for that. But you would have settled Al-Basra's affairs. Why? Because this ruler was an evil ruler. Abu Ubaidullah bin Ziyad was the ruler of Al-Basra, and he recently was given Al-Kufa by Yazid bin Muawiyah. But Abu Ubaidullah bin Ziyad was an insolent oppressor. He was an insolent oppressor. You tell him, had you killed him, you would have killed an insolent oppressor. So do we say that these people are Khawarij? No. Because this person is an insolent oppressor, and his death is better than his life. So basically, Shariq was telling him that if you had killed him, you would have settled Al-Basra's affairs, because Al-Basra was suffering under his oppression. It had been alleged by some that Ubaidullah bin Ziyad went back to the house of Shariq bin Al-A'war, where Muslim bin Aqil was there, and attempted to kill him, although Hani did not permit them to enter his house. The chiefs, now this is the problem that happened, the chiefs subsequently took Hani bin Urwa before Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. So the chiefs also wanted dunya. And this is actually, subhanAllah, this is something that's being used and utilized by the Americans and the Jews until today. So the Jews have tried to go to the chiefs of the tribes of the tribes in Gaza so that they can revolt against the Mujahideen. But the chiefs told them that we are one single hand with the Mujahideen. Similarly, in Iraq, when the Americans invaded, they went to the chiefs and they put the chiefs under their care and under their protection, and they bought them off, basically. And the chiefs colluded with the Americans against the Mujahideen who were fighting against the Americans. So this matter of the chiefs in Iraq happened then. And these are the chiefs, as we will see later, that told their followers to go away from al-Hussein and not support him. And these chiefs are the reason for the death of al-Hussein radiallahu anhu. We will stop here, inshallah, and we'll continue another lesson. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us the beneficial knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show us the truth and enable us to follow it, irrespective of the consequences. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us and our families and our provisions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the best of our deeds, the last ones. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give victory to our brothers, the mujahideen, in Palestine, in Lebanon, in Iraq, in Syria, in Yemen, and in everywhere that the mujahideen are waging all types of jihad against the enemies of Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to destroy the state of the Jews and to make the might of the Jews greatest amongst each other, and to destroy their evil state and purify the blessed land of Palestine from the filth of the Jews, and purify the land of Islam from the filth of the hypocrites. I bring back the Khilafah to Jerusalem, as he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised us. And finally, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the best of our deeds, the last ones, and to gather us with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the highest paradise for the Firdaus. Akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.